Shana Goldin-Perschbacher is Assistant Professor of Music History at Temple University and is a faculty fellow at the University of Pennsylvania's Humanities Forum on Sex. Her ethnographic, historical, and analytical scholarship on popular music engages with feminist, queer, transgender, and critical race studies. Her essay, Transamericana, Gender, Genre, and Journey, appeared in the 2015 volume New Literary History, and she has published essays on identity in the music of Jeff Buckley, Michelle Negadacello, and Bjork. Today's presentation, do you have it?
If you grew up in a nothing town where they sing the same song in every house, then I can see what made you so hungry to stick up, to stand out, to be set apart, to make a sound, to be someone new.
Album Armor, award-winning white transgender Canadian singer-songwriter, author, and film subject Ray Spoon sings that it's understandable that those from a nothing town where they sing the same song in every house would try on other people's sounds to be someone new in the big city. But, as Spoon sings, you can take it off, and that's why it doesn't belong to you. In the next chorus, Spoon changes the you to I to claim responsibility in this common practice of adopting other people's music as a way to reframe one's identity. It's a common practice, particularly, as Spoon's song notes, for middle-class people from the suburbs who think that they come from a nothing town where tastes are uniform and seen as boring. The other people in Stolen Song are marked by not being able to take it off, where it is presumably the stolen song. This phrase implies an enticing musical object possessed by an owner, one that marks this person as different. It seems to be something that cannot be removed and is perhaps understood as essential. Spoon mentioned in interviews with journalists and in conversation with me that this song was inspired by a recent music video depicting a relatively famous cisgender actor costumed as transgender in a song that seems to be about articulating a case for recognition and acceptance of gender nonconforming people. Spoon says, a couple of years ago, a band put out a music video with a gender variant protagonist. I felt like the portrayal only perpetuated stereotypes about trans/gender diverse people. It really upset me because no one in the band or the actor was gender variant or transgender. It felt like my identity was being treated like a costume to make the band appear more interesting. Then I realized that there are a lot of these examples in the music and arts industry. I have also mistakenly appropriated culture from other people. Stolen Song is a call to folks, including myself, to stop using identities that don't belong to us in our art. Musically, the song is upbeat and has some great drum programming by Berlin artist Alexandra de Coupigny. I wanted it to sound optimistic and positive. Spoon's strategy of including themselves in the critique and broadening the misrepresentation or theft to other types of identification, like race, is what made me want to talk about this song today, to think about Spoon's stolen song and the song that prompted it, as well as the discourse around the songs. This conversation alludes to and directly discusses other racial identification, empowerment, and misrepresentation or appropriation, often in the hands of middle-class white people, in the context of gay and or transgender identification, especially around narratives of visibility and equality. So first, I just wanted to give a little background. Spoon, who is retired from gender and uses they has written two memoirs and is featured in a fantastic autobiographical documentary called My Prairie Home about leaving their hometown of Calgary and becoming estranged from their Pentecostal family, especially their abusive father, as they first realized they were queer and then identified as a trans man before retiring from gender. At the turn of the century, they moved to Vancouver and became a country musician, which was a surprise to them in some ways, but they explain it as a result of moving to the liberal West Coast and yet feeling a sense of still being quite Albertan on the inside and feeling a connection with their oil rig worker uncle's musical tastes and masculinity and identifying with Hank Williams, who sounded as lonely as I felt, Spoon wrote. They toured and recorded as a country singer for 6 years before branching out into electronic and indie music, partly inspired by living in Germany and Montreal, but also because of realizing that the country venues were not very trans or queer friendly. They now live in Victoria. I've been talking to and thinking about Spoon and their awesome multimedia body of work as part of a book project on transgender and queerly gendered country and folk musicians, a project which started when I heard a band in 2004 and became a fan and later got to know several musicians of the 100 bands I've come to learn about. I'm a cisgender person who is attracted to cisgender men, butches, and trans men. So I'd like to think about how race is discussed in relation to misrepresentation of trans people in these two songs. Issues of authenticity are of special importance to transgender people, who often, but not always, are expected or demanded to explain their gender identification to others in a way that is not often asked of most people. Although I think that a lot of people are asked about their race or ethnicity or have assumptions made about their abilities and bodies and religion. But this notion of having to convince someone that you are in fact the gender or non-gender you identify as and that the person you're talking to may have to shift how they understand or treat you is different from how people are often othered by race. Illogical, ignorant, and harmful scholarship like Janice Raymond's 1979 book, The Transsexual Empire, argued that trans women are simply men who appropriate femininity in order to infiltrate and destroy feminism. This is an argument stemming from ignorance of the continued effort and sometimes risk it takes to be transgender and a lack of acknowledgement that trans women have been and continue to be important feminist activists. And I bring it up as an important example of the importance of self-identification. Trans people and other oppressed peoples have every right to a sense of authentic self and a protection against the theft of identifiable markers of self or group, which sometimes takes the form of putting on another identity as a costume, or other times sounds like stealing their music. But I'm trying to reconcile this notion of the ownership of sound or song as a self that cannot be taken off in relation to the last 25 years of scholarship on identity and music, which draws from social constructionist understandings of identity. I'm thinking of scholarship like Nina Eidsheim's recent work challenging vocal pedagogy's assumptions of essential racial difference in the sound of people's voices, and Carl Hagstrom Miller's argument that while black and white Southern musicians could sing or play many styles of music, the music industry shoehorned them into racialized and regionalized roles. One of his examples is the Texan singer Vernon Dalhart, who in the first couple decades of the 20th century wanted to become an opera singer, but ended up being encouraged to perform Negro dialect, basically blackface songs, and country music. Still, the notion of voice or a song as representative of a person or people endures from 17th and 18th century Christian thought, claims Stephen Connor, who writes, "The politics of voice is inseparable from this phonographic hunger. The ethical injunction against the reduction of others to the condition of objects suggests the injunction against the theft or misuse of the attributes of the other, especially of their voice. But it is only as a result of having been thus construed as a possessable and therefore alienable kind of object that the voice can appear vulnerable to such illegitimate appropriation." As Connor argues, the idea of the theft of voice, reducing someone to an object who can be possessed, depends on notions of otherness that people think can be appropriated. Nadine Hubbs, engaging sociologist Beverly Skeggs' research on the working class, believes that in these scenarios, certain selves are fixed so that others can be mobile. Skeggs and Hubbs note that culturally devalued people, such as the working class and people of color, tend to have their identities fixed in place, essentialized and devalued, while the middle class are allowed to borrow from these identifications in ways that offer value to the borrowers while fixing the borrowed from as valueless. So when I teach this, I like to think of the trucker hat. So it doesn't really do any good to the trucker in terms of cultural value, but to the hipster who puts on the trucker hat, it's seen as cool. Makes them seem different. They come from a nothing town where everybody's the same. These fixed selves make money for middlemen and the music industry, but the musicians are caught in a tough place. Historian Benjamin Filen identifies the irony of the appeal of what he calls outsider populism, in which othered citizens are positioned, often by the middle class, as exemplary common people, a process that both solidifies a sense of otherness and yet draws audience identification with other people's, quote, grit and character. Filen supports this argument with the example of the Lomax's marketing of Leadbelly, who, by intimate accounts, was a sharp dresser and a peaceful person, yet was pushed after his release from prison to perform barefoot wearing his prison uniform, and was marketed by the Lomaxes as someone coming to East Coast colleges to play some music between committing homicides. I have inferred from my discussions with Spoon that the video in question is We Exist, a 2014 song by the American and Canadian band Arcade Fire. Spoon has not named the band or song in these conversations with journalists or with me, or in Stolen Song, so I mention it here despite Spoon's thoughtful decision to focus on everyone's misrepresentation of others, because I think it's helpful to discuss how both songs and the surrounding discourse engage questions of race in thinking about representation of gender. The phrase "we exist" seems to imply that some people think that gay or trans people don't exist. Spoon and the members of Arcade Fire were living in the same neighborhood of Montreal at the time. Responding to the "We Exist" line of the song, Spoon said to me that they wanted to indicate to Arcade Fire, hey, I'm here, I'm alive, basically, hey, I exist, but that would have revealed the name of the song. Spoon does not think that any of the band members of Arcade Fire identify as non-normatively gendered. So while the band seemed to mean well by creating the song and accompanying video, they used transgender identification as a costume and seemed to speak directly on behalf of trans people while not thoroughly consulting anyone trans about this song or video. And one exception is that the lead character of the video, actor Andrew Garfield, known for his role as Spider-Man, was coached by the transgender artist Our Lady J. But several have noted that this did not prevent problems with the video. One major issue with the song is whether it's about a gay or transgender character. The band seemed to think that the song was about a gay character, but then the video seems to figure a transgender character, although the discussion after the major critique of the video revealed that the band members and director are still using different terms and pronouns to describe the main character. Another major problem is why a cisgender band felt the need to argue for the existence of either gay or transgender people, especially since they don't seem to have interacted with any transgender people while writing the song. According to lead singer Win Butler, the premise is that the narrator is a gay Jamaican kid coming out to his father and was inspired by a trip to Jamaica where they wrote their album Reflector and witnessing homophobia there. Butler says when asked about the casting of Garfield in the video, quote, for a gay kid in Jamaica to see the actor who played Spider-Man in that role is pretty damn powerful in my opinion. Transgender lead singer of the band Against Me, Laura Jane Grace, went so far as to compare the phenomenon to, quote, white actors in blackface. The plot of the 5-minute video for Arcade Fire's We Exist has been convoluted by the band and director after responding to heavy critique. So if you go to, like, the Wikipedia page about this song and video, like, the pronouns and terms gay or transgender shift, like, between sentences inexplicably, but using quotes from the different people involved in making this. To different viewers, it has seemed to be either about a white person, Sandy, played by Andrew Garfield, living in a rural place who has been assigned male at birth and is taking steps to transition to womanhood, but Wynne Butler says it's about a gay man who's experimenting with gender performance as an expression of sexuality. So I just want to play a little bit. They depict this character as having no support network and getting beat up for dancing with a man in a country bar, when in reality, many trans people have friends and don't get beat up for having relationships. And violence towards gay and or trans people that find a path to happiness through moving to the coast. So I'm sorry to even show that part of her getting beat up. So she has a extended solo dance scene that's a sort of fantasy moment. And then she is surrounded by a phantasmatic community of gay friends who she apparently doesn't have in real life. Basically, the phantasmatic gay friends invite the character to Coachella, the once local and independent artistic festival in California that's now very corporatized, and these scenes were filmed live on stage there. So she's accepted by the 20-something middle-class white hipster audience where everybody loves her and her cowboy boots and happily sing along We Exist. Director David Wilson, who is gay, says that the Coachella audience, quote, accept her just the way that she feels and just the way that she is. But as ethnographer Mary Gray writes, based on her study of LGBTQ youth in Kentucky, while the country has been set up by queer visibility politics as a huge closet to an urban queer utopia, rural spaces have for a long time allowed queerness to exist, if not to flourish, as long as it did not affect the person's commitment to the tenets that hold rural life together, family and community, As Gray argues, familiarity is crucial in rural communities, and the politics of out and proud, visibility and difference, make it difficult, if not impossible, for rural queers to follow previous generations' open secret. In an article about the video, Laura Jane Gray's critical response, advocate author Lucas Grindley writes, quote, "There is something powerful in what both Butler and Grace are trying to say, though seemingly from opposite sides of the debate. Whether trans or gay, it's important to be visible for a lot of reasons. But for whom is it important that trans and gay characters are visible, especially in a video like this? To return to Benjamin Filene's notion of outsider populism, it seems clear that this concept is most valuable to the unmarked, seemingly normal people consuming a marked other who they have decided is a hero. In We Exist, the trans character is only accepted because of her grit and character surviving the scenes of abuse that the cisgender director was eager to place her in, until her middle-class saviors welcome her on stage at Coachella. I'm still working on understanding this tension between Spoot's important work showing trans thriving and trans and other people's rights to represent themselves, and yet the complicated work that a concept like a stolen song enacts. Spoon shares their strategy for inspiring feelings of community among their audience, raising critical issues through song, that I thought I would close with. Quote, it's okay as long as everybody feels like they're in the club. If you said, hey, all of you are racist, and in fact they all are, I mean we all are, it wouldn't have the same effect. But as long as everyone feels like they're in the club, they don't feel threatened. That's the beauty of art. It takes you places you wouldn't go. Sometimes I invite them into the queer world. Sometimes people want to be invited, you know. I look forward to your feedback. Thanks.
Thank you for an interesting paper. Are there any questions? We have time for about one question. Yeah, Ella.
Your work is so smart and in really exciting ways, and this paper was no exception to that.
I wondered, just two parts, and they're related, but I'll try to be brief. What you, or if you think about E. Patrick Johnson's work on appropriation, right, where he's critiquing the politics of authenticity, that blackness, in particular in his book, but also sexuality, belong to certain bodies, right? And there's certain bodies who can and should perform them and not, right? And he wants to get us away from thinking of a politics of appropriation and authenticity and think and use performance to think about what's at stake in different performances, right, of blackness or of queerness, of black queerness. And relatedly, I wondered if you could tease out race a bit more in your paper. I was struck by Laura Jane Grace's right, it's like white actors in blackface, right, where, and this is the article that I'm just finished writing, so I'm thinking about this, but like, that the appropriation of who gets to perform queerness is always already racialized as white, mm-hmm. right, and so queerness, the boundaries of queerness are marketed by comparing it to race. Because it seems to me that the anxiety around appropriation is about whiteness in a certain type of way, and I was just wondering if you could comment on that.
Yeah, I've started looking at Johnson's book, but I haven't been able to work it into this paper yet, so thank you so much for that. And I think you're absolutely right. I agree. I think that the anxiety here is around white representations, and yeah, I guess that you know, my initial work was sort of teasing out what how it's sort of an unspoken whiteness that's discussed in these two pieces, and yet that the impetus behind both of them seems to be about non-whiteness and an anxiety there, that like that Butler talked about the We Exist song and, you know, reacting to homophobia in Jamaica, like, so he doesn't want to talk about homophobia or transphobia or racism in America, but when he went to Jamaica, it seemed like super obvious and anxiety producing, and so he wanted to write a song about this. And yet, like, instead of featuring like a black gay Jamaican kid, you know, singing to his father, it's this white cis character who gets, you know, enveloped by the band's friendly audience at Coachella. And Butler had said, like, yeah, like, a lot of us don't think about this because we've got Whole Foods and stuff, and, you know, so we just don't really imagine that this happens. Like, so, yeah, I guess that I found this call for papers and symposium as an invitation to start to think through some of these issues that are kind of that popped up as I was working on this different project, but with one of these same musicians. So I totally agree with you, and I'd love to take it in that direction.
Thank you very much, Shana.